Hello everyone, welcome back to the new episode of podcast with BL Inside Circle. Today we have a very special guest, because who would have believed that you study finance and you would come back to India to do farming? So all the three partners, starting from our guest Mr. Vishal M. Gadda, he has done MSc finance in from Lancaster University in UK. He has done Masters in Accounting from Macquarie University in Australia. He's CPA Australia, CFA USA. His partner, Mr. Sagar Thakkar, he's MCOM, CA in India and Australia. The third partner, Mr. Kalpesh Arya, he has done Masters in International Business from UK. So all the three partners, as you see, they are very heavy with education background, strong finance education. But they choose to come back to India and venture into farming. So this is very interesting to me, and I'm sure to everyone, you also. So let's hear directly from Mr. Vishal Gadda. Hello, Vishal sir.
Hi, how are you guys doing?
All good, sir.
Yeah.
Let's start with our first question. We are very curious that all three of you, you as well as Sagar and Kalpesh Arya, all three are very, very, you have studied and very strong finance accounting background, but you chose to come back to India and venture into farming, agriculture, and your company, Aurus Agro, which was started in 2013, heavy into farming and agriculture. Tell us more about this and why this journey.
Yeah, so basically, I've done my master's in finance from UK. I come back to India, then I was working with BNP Paribas at that time in credit risk, then got an opportunity, I flew to Australia, I did my master's in accounting from there, and then did my CPA, CFA. I was working in investment bank at that time, more on the mining side. So we used to do pre-IPOs, raising funds for junior exploratory companies. We've helped a couple of Indian companies to buy mines overseas, South Africa, Australia. Then we've got various family businesses, and that's when the pressure was there, you know, to come back home being the only son. But I always wanted to do something on my own. So when I came back, Kalpesh is my mama's son. Sagar is also our neighbor, and we three have grown together. So the bonding was very much there. So we started with this investment banking journey. And then we are helping mining companies out from India, like in the investment banking space. But then there was slowdown in the mining sector. Even in India, in Kutch, I started my own bentonite mining. But then there was a slowdown in the mining industry. That's when we thought that we should do something in the agricultural space. And given our strong connect with the Australian Australian companies, so we were helping, you know, a lot of corporates to do road shows in India. That's where we were helping some seeds companies, and then we laid our hands on this company called Seed Genetics International. They were the largest Lucerne seed exporters from Australia. So Lucerne is basically alfalfa, or in India it's known as Ranchka, Richka, and it's the best fodder. It's called King of Fodders. So it was one of the best products that we tried our hands on, and we basically held this company in India. So we did research trials across India, government, private, everything. Finally, we got a mandate from them, and we got a tripartite agreement signed between UPL, Advanta, Seed Genetics, and ourselves, where we were like sort of a broker to the deal, and Advanta was supposed to, you know, take this step forward. But then this company, Seed Genetics, got taken over by a NASDAQ-listed company, and the whole deal went on a back burner. So at that time, we started our own seed production for the fodder category. We were doing African tall maize seeds and all that. So we thought, you know, we've got a lot of land in Kutch, so why not do something in the agri space ourselves in the Kutch region? So we thought that, you know, let's start with a 15-acre sort of an orchard, a family orchard kind of a thing. But we didn't want to do something what everyone was doing, like Kutch is famous for his kesar mangoes, dates, off-late pomegranates. We wanted to do something different. So we did a lot of research on what can be done in Kutch. and we saw cactus. So we thought, you know, what fruit bearing cactus can be there? That's when we thought of dragon fruit, and then we directly jumped on, you know, 15 acres of dragon fruit at that time. So that's how our journey in the dragon fruit market started, basically.
So Vishal sir, I presume you as in your farming group was one of the first in India to start the farming business of dragon fruit. So you had the first mover advantage for this, or so tell us more about this dragon fruit journey and why, what difficulties, or how did the dragon fruit journey began with your company?
Sure. So basically, as I said, we were into investment banking in Australia, and there was family pressure for me to come back to India, because we were into, you know, various family businesses that we've got. But I always wanted to do something on my own, and so I continued with this investment banking thing with the bosses in Australia, and we were helping Australian companies to do business in India. I also started with my mining company in India, into bentonite mining in Kutch itself, and helping, you know, Australian company. Then we started, you know, helping Australian agricultural companies. So we're helping vegetable seeds company, and then finally Lucent seed, basically Lucent alfalfa is the king of order in India. It's known as Ranchka or Richka. So we were helping this company called Seed Genetic International, which is the largest Lucent seed exporter out of Australia. So we did the research trials from them for India on, you know, how the weather is there for the growth of their seeds and all that. And finally, you know, results were very good. And we got a tripartite agreement with Advanta for marketing of seeds. Seed Genetics will be growing the seeds in India. And since we brokered the deal, so we are part of the entire journey. But then this company got taken over by a NASDAQ listed company, and the entire project went on a back burner. But at least, you know, side by side, we were doing our own seed business, where we were growing African tall maize for the fodder sector. And then we thought, you know, we've got a lot of land in Kutch, so let's do something in the Kutch region. At that time, in Kutch, mainly, you know, Kesar mangoes, dates, pomegranates were being grown. We didn't want to do what everyone was doing. We wanted to do something different. So that's one, we thought, what can be done in the region? And we saw cactus, and we thought, you know, what cactus bearing fruit can be there? That's when we learned about dragon fruit. And we got in touch with the largest grower out of Australia, Marcus, on how he's growing and what he's doing. We visited Vietnam before we started our journey. And then finally, we got our planting material from Sri Lanka, the Taiwanese sweet variety that we got from Sri Lanka. And that's how our journey started. So basically, as you are aware that, you know, being from the accounting finance background with without knowing A of agriculture, we jumped into a big 15-acre project. At that time, it was the largest in India, and red dragon fruit no one had done at that time. So it was by far the largest. And again, we didn't have any consultant to help us out in India. So there were a lot of agri consultants, like the soil scientist and, you know, knowing every other plant. But they didn't have us. I mean, there was zero knowledge on dragon fruit. So you can say practically, we definitely had the first mover's advantage in a way that all these consultants were, you know, they didn't know about dragon fruit. So we learned it the hard way. We removed consultants. We went totally organic. We learned a lot of in-depth knowledge on dragon fruit growing in general, about agriculture, what our forefathers used to do, how, you know, we can get in some of the equipments and, you know, improve our scalability and all. So we've done a lot of changes at our end. And now we are at a stage that, you know, we are giving consultancy to a lot of farmers across India in dragon fruit. So definitely we had the first mover's advantage in the dragon fruit industry in terms of farming. Again, on the selling side also, the sales side, again, we had a first mover's advantage on the sales side as well.
So, sir, my next question would be on the diversification. Do you see a diversification in the portfolio for Auroch? considering 80% of the dragon fruit is still being, you know, imported from Vietnam? I mean, what is Auroch's core focus at this point in terms of the product portfolio?
Okay, so as you very rightly said, in today's term, whatever is being consumed is being, 80% is being imported from mainly Vietnam. And this consumption is mainly in, say, tier 1, 2, 3 cities. And I would say still not many people are aware of dragon fruit. So when we started, as I said, you know, earlier, that people would have, you know, eaten the white dragon fruit. And they said that when we said that, okay, try dragon fruit, they said, no, bahut fika hai, it is tasteless fruit, how can you have it? Or people did not know, but when we said that, you know, it's white with black seeds inside and all, so they said, oh yes, we've had it, you know, overseas, or we've had it in someone's wedding or something, but no, it was free or something, that's why we had it, otherwise we are not, you know, we don't want to eat it. So that's when we, you know, we gave the red fruit to people, and then they started liking the taste, and that's how, you know, they started recommending us to a lot of people, and that's how the demand for dragon fruit has been growing. Secondly, doctors have been recommending dragon fruit for, you know, dengue or cancer or something like that. So people started, you know, taking this fruit as a medicine fruit. So we again started a campaign that this is not a medicinal fruit, it is a health fruit. So we've been, you know, doing a lot of marketing to, you know, pinpoint the uses and advantages of dragon fruit. So that's been, you know, very helpful. So as of now, definitely we are increasing our dragon fruit acreage. Like existing, we've got 65 acres in Kutch, our own personal farms. Then 10 acres, we bought a JV with another farmer in Kutch itself. We bought 5 acres in Sangli. Then we are developing 150 acres in Sangam near Shirdi. So that's going to be dragon fruit plus agrotourism project. That's what we are coming up with. And besides this, our company is now diversifying into Moringa leaves production. So we'll be going for Moringa leaves, dehydrating them, making into powder, and making various products of Moringa leaves. Again, with dragon fruit, we've got a lot of value-added products ready with us, like, say, wine, dehydrated powder, dehydrated chips, jam, jelly, everything. But we don't have enough fruit in our hand that we can commercialize all these value-added products. So any product that is going to come on Auroch Agro's bandwagon is basically we look at scaling up these products and value adding them and making different products out of the fresh products. That's something that we are looking at. And off late, within a month's time, we'll be coming up with a bamboo, 20 acre bamboo research project on our lands in Kutch. So if that goes success, we'll be then, you know, replicating. I mean, we'll be going that on a very big scale.
Since the founders have a very strong financial background, financial education background, so how do you see the business? How do you see it more from the product side or more from the financial side? So how do you try to balance the two?
Definitely. I mean, see, not only that we are from an accounting finance background, but we are from business family. So, I mean, Yambaniyas basically. So definitely, you know, finance runs in our blood and we can understand only finance, nothing else. So whatever project that we do, it's more from a financial angle. We look at the financial viability. We look at, you know, what cost is going in, what is the cost of production, cost of marketing, cost of logistics. If increases, I mean, is it scalable? If we are scaling up the project, how can we reduce the cost, reduce the logistics cost? So it's always numbers for us. Numbers is key for us. We don't think from the agricultural, you know, what the farmers would think, you know, that this has to be done this way or that way or something. And wherever, if mechanization is needed, be it big, small, we always jump into mechanization so that we can save on labor. Because labor is very difficult to get these days. Definitely we think more of numbers and we take all our projects that way.
The next question that I had for you was on the lines of government support. Like, we know that farming is actually quite a labor-intensive job. And what kind, and are the, since this was a new fruit that was being brought into the industry, was there any government support that you could rely on for launching this new kind of fruit in the Indian markets?
See, in a way, I would say government is quite supportive in the farming sector. So basically, when we started this project, Dragon fruit was completely a new product for India when we started. But still, we approached National Horticulture Board at that time in 2014. And we showed them, you know, the planting material. We got the fruit because we did not have the harvest at that time. But we showed them the fruit and everything. So we gave it to the MD and to the committee and all at that time. And they were quite supportive. They said, so generally the subsidies in the agricultural sector is credit link. That means you need to take a bank loan and your subsidy would go into the bank account. And after 3 years, it gets released or it gets offset between your loan, with your loan. So basically the government is trying to put the onus on the banks to do all the due diligence that the farmer who's taking the loan to make sure that, you know, the project is successful and the bank should pay a visit every year or every quarter to see if the project is going good and the loans are being repaid. So it's a very wonderful process what our government has got. So at that time, we definitely got the subsidy, but it is, you know, a little bit disheartening to know that, you know, after that, we had put a couple of projects for which we did not get the subsidy. So we approached Kutch Chamber of Commerce and our Kutch local MP that, you know, there should be some subsidy in this. And through them, we've written letters to the PM, Finance Ministry, Agri Ministry, both center, state. And we are very happy now that, you know, at least at the state level in Gujarat, and I think even in Maharashtra, they've started giving subsidy for dragon fruit. But I was still, you know, my plea is still with the government to, you know, give subsidy from the center, from NHB for bigger projects as well, and not just for the small projects. Besides this, you know, Gujarat government give subsidy on drip, and they even give interest subsidy. So we've availed even the interest subsidy as well on for this project. So definitely, you know, there are a lot of schemes from the government, both center, state, that are very useful to the farmers. Yeah, so I mean, we are happy with what's happening.
Before we conclude, one final question I had for you was, you coming back to India, starting farming in your local region, local area. So it seems like there's a very strong connect of society. So how do you think, envisage, you know, is you giving back to the society by setting up the farms in your area? How do you see that?
Yes, I mean, my family in a way has got a very strong connect with our village. And on our village level, I mean, we've done a lot of activities for the, you know, villagers staying on a permanent basis out there. And what we do at our farms is also unique. I mean, we believe in women empowerment. So most of our laborers are women. Even on the selling side, we've got a very unique model where we've got homemakers, generally, I mean, housewives, who sell our product. So, as I said earlier, so our product has, you know, gone from word to mouth publicity. And I mean, this is the best channel that we've got. They've got kitty parties or building groups or something. So we appoint them, and that's where, you know, they then start disseminating the information. Because again, women are the main decision makers for anything that you eat at your home. So that's how also, you know, it's helped us a lot. So that's on women empowerment. Secondly, I mean, we are we believe in, you know, cow welfare and all. So there's a gaushala, not gaushala, I would say, but a panjapod. So panjapod is something where all the stray cattles are taken care of. So these cattles can be, you know, accident prone cattles also, or they are not giving milk, or I mean, something or the other, something negative, and you know these panjapurs take care of them. So since they are not milking, so there's no source of income for this panjapur. So they are always, you know, dependent on donations from outside. So what we've done is, you know, we've made wells for the water for drinking for these cattle. We even laid a pipeline to get, you know, a secondary source of water for them. Now we are running the biogas plant at this panjapur. So whatever the cow dung comes, we process it in the biogas plant. And whatever slurry comes, we put it on our field. So that's considered gold for us. And we are organic. We are, in fact, certified organic. We got organic certification from Bureau Veritas, which is a French company. You can see the level of, you know, due diligence that we are doing at our farm. And whatever gas is coming from this biogas is used by this panjapur for the cooking and various activities that they have to do. So in a way, you know, they are getting self-reliant from the gas and the from the sales of this slurry that they do that they give. Then last year we've given around 500 kilos of dragon fruit to Seven Hills Hospital in Bombay. So that was for the COVID patients and the COVID warriors. So dragon fruit, as you are aware, has got, you know, a lot of health benefits. It's multivitamin, multi-nutrient. I mean, it's got, you know, A, B, B12, C, everything in it. Then it's also useful for pregnant ladies because it's got iron and zinc in it. It's an immunity booster, which is the need of the hour in COVID. In fact, you know, a lot of doctors, they recommend dragon fruit to their cancer patients. And also, especially, you know, for the blood cells, for replenishing the white blood cells or the red blood cells, red dragon fruit is very effective. It's recommended before or, you know, after chemo, because it gives you a lot of strength, stamina. So that way, you know, we've donated to the Seven Hills Hospital. And this year, again, we are planning to give it not only into COVID hospital, but also start giving it in cancer hospitals as well. So that's our plan for this year. And besides this, I mean, we do a lot of grocery donations to the tribal regions in Gujarat. Because a lot of families are displaced, you know, or lost work during COVID. So basically, that's our bit. I mean, we are earning from the society. That's our bit of giving back to the society. Again, this year, a very unique thing that we've started in Kutch is we've donated in conjunction with Aarti Group, Mr. Chandrakant Gogri, and our family has given excavator for Kutch. This would be used for water conservation. So what basically we are trying to do is any village that wants to avail this facility, they just have to pay for the diesel of this excavator. You don't have to pay for anything else, just the diesel. And they can remove this jungle bubble tree, which are a nuisance in the region. Then they can use this excavator to deepen their ponds, lakes, so that, you know, whatever water is coming, that can be conserved on their land. And they can make canals out of it. So whatever needs to be done on the water conservation side can be done with the use of this excavator. So that's, I mean, probably, I mean, what we are doing, you know, for the society at large.
Okay, one last question coming from a MBA graduate. I am interested in this business. So say I or maybe anyone, because I am assuming the ROI is lucrative. So if I want to set up something in this, or if I want to invest something which is directly or indirectly related to dragon fruit, can I at this stage do it? Or if I can do it, is it routed only through your Aarog company, or do we have other ventures, other groups in India which can help more in the farming business of dragon fruit?
So basically, we are the largest, as I said, growers of dragon fruit in India. And I doubt, you know, anyone else is doing at this scale what we are doing, which mainly the farmers who are doing dragon fruit. So again, I mean, see, if you want to be directly, you know, related to farming, so it's, I mean, a piece of advice to anyone out there that if you want to go into agriculture, it's a game of patience and passion. So only if you are passionate about nature and farming, then only enter into this business. Because agriculture, like say, basically industry or a factory, you know, whatever input that you would be putting in, you'll be getting that quality output. So your raw material will, you know, equate to your finished goods. And you know, if something has gone wrong in the machine or labor has hampered something, accordingly, your output will differ. But in agriculture, the biggest challenge that you are up and against is nature. So same time last year was different, same time last month was different, last week was different, last second was different. So every time you are against the nature, so whatever you have to plan, it is like say three days before, 1 week before something. So all those planning goes into, you know, your production, harvesting. So everything, you know, whatever you plan, not necessarily that would equate to a better product. So that's the biggest challenge. So if you are up for it, definitely, I mean, farming is one of the best things to do. You are with the nature, you're calm, passionate. I mean, definitely join on. Again, I mean, it's a misconception that for farming, you need land. I would say, no, not at all. You can go on a Uber-like model, like what we are doing. We the company is not allowed to own land, actually, especially in Gujarat. Maharashtra, yes, you can own land. The company, I'm saying. Otherwise, individuals definitely can own land. So what we are doing is, like, even this, the first project that we've got, or, you know, different projects, we're doing JVs with the landowners, where, or the first project was a lease. So we've done a lease with my family, where we are paying lease payment to my family. Other projects, we are doing JV. So the land and the finance is theirs. We are the technical partners and we are taking care of the whole project. That's how we get the revenues. And as you said that, you know, indirect investment into the dragon fruit or the agricultural sector, definitely, I mean, Auroch Agro is planning to scale up the productions. And for that, definitely, we'll be looking at more funds and IPO would be the route for, you know, getting the funds. So maybe soon we'll be looking at, you know, IPO coming up, and for growth, we'll also be looking at, you know, other acquiring other projects, be it hydroponics or something like that. So we are looking at organic, inorganic, both growths in the agricultural sector. And again, I mean, we are strong on the trading side as well. So as I said that, you know, we bought our the marketing channel for us. So what? So during the season, they are selling dragon fruit, but outside the season, we started marketing of seasonal fruits like, say, mangoes, be it Kesar mango or carbide free Alfonso mangoes, then Kutch dates, pomegranates, oranges from Amaravati. We do even imported exotic fruits that we trade. So everything is B2C mainly that we are doing. I would like to add one more thing. It's a pride moment for us that being from non-agricultural background, we've been awarded Krishi Award from, Sardar Patel Krishi Award from Gujarat government in the year 2019. We have been featured in our Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Mann Ki Baat when he had spoken about dragon fruit. That's our dragon fruits farms that were shown in his video. In fact, on his recommendation, forest officers from the Statue of Unity area, they had visited our farms and we had been awarded the contract to set up dragon fruit plantation. So they've set up a cactus garden on the foothills of Statue of Unity. So 1 acre was, you know, earmarked for us to put up dragon fruit plantation out there. And I mean, we've been featured in a lot of papers and news media like papers, TV, Air India, Doordarshan. I mean, sorry, not Air India, All India Radio, Doordarshan, everywhere. We've been featured everywhere, you know, on our success and the model that we are doing. And we've, you know, touched, helped a lot of farmers across India. Like, we are directly consulting across 400 acres of farmers across India, where we've given them the dragon fruit material. We are helping them on farm management. And even we help them sell the products. So that's, I mean, quite a good journey for us in definitely in the dragon fruit area. And we're looking at the same success in bamboo also now.
Right. All this just speaks the volume of the success your company has gotten up till now. So thank you, Vishal sir, on behalf of the class of 2022 and BL Insight Circle. We extend a final thank you to you. It was very interesting to hear from your journey from global business to coming back to India and venturing into dragon fruit farming, and your research from the seeding research and the research trial, and then finally launching the dragon fruit into the Indian market. We had multiple takeaways. One of the first takeaways is launching a new product in a new market, and then finally understanding the right product for the customers. It was very interesting to know about the journey of your company, Aarog, and maybe for an expected IPO, it'll be an honor to get an IPO. We hope the viewers and listeners had multiple takeaways also. Thank you so much, finally. Thank you so much, Vishal sir.
Thank you.